Well, hey, Chuck, how can I help you?
I've been looking at this book, and there's all kinds of crazy chords. I mean, what is an A minus 7?
It looks like you've stumbled onto the real book, and the real book is full of jazz standards, which means all of these are jazz chords. Now, terminology in jazz can be a little bit different. So, for example, that A minus 7, well, the minus sign simply means minor. So, tell you what, let's do a lesson on jazz chords, some of the most commonly used ones that you may come across. And all of these are going to be movable forms like we did a couple of lessons ago. Does that sound like a plan? It sure does. I'll go get my guitar. As we learn these jazz chords, we're going to be studying some movable forms with roots on the 6th, 5th, and 4th strings. Now, a couple of lessons ago, we learned movable major 7 chords. So in this lesson, we're going to start with minor 7 chords. Now, we did study minor 7 chords in that other lesson, except the voicings will be a little different here in jazz. So here's a C minor 7 chord, root on the 6th string, minor 7 on the 4th string, minor 3rd on the 2nd string, and a 5th on the 2nd string. Here's another C minor 7 chord, the root on the 5th string. We have 2/3 in this case. We have the minor 3rd on the 4th string and also on the 2nd string. The minor 7 is the 3rd string. Notice there's no 5th. It's not terribly uncommon to omit the 5th in a jazz voicing. And yeah, here's another one, a C minor 7 chord on the 4th string is the root. So we've got our root on the 4th string, we have our 5th on the 3rd string, we have our minor 7 on the 2nd string, and the minor 3rd on the 1st string. Now those minor 7 flat 5 chords. This is the same thing as a half diminished 7 chord, just the common terminology in jazz is minor 7 flat 5. So here it is with the 6th string as the root, with the flat 5 on the 5th string, the minor 7 on the 4th string, and the minor 3rd on the 3rd string. Here it is a 5th string form. The root on the 5th string, the flat 5 is on the 4th string, the minor 7 on the 3rd string, and the minor 3rd on the 2nd string. Here it is with a 4th string form. The root is on the 4th string, the flat 5 is on the 3rd string, the minor 7 is on the 2nd string, and the minor 3rd is on the 1st string. Let's talk about dominant chords. So it's very rare that in jazz you're going to play just a regular dominant 7 chord. You'll have that dominant 7, but it'll have some added notes. And that's usually a 9 or a 13 or something like that. So I'm going to show you a C13. This is our 6th string form. So the root is on the 6th string, the minor 7 on the 4th string, the major 3rd on the 3rd string, and the 13 is on the 2nd string. Now I can flat that 13. Now I have to call it a C7 flat 13. Now I'm going to play a C9 fifth string form. Fifth string is the root. The fourth string is the third. The minor 7 is going to be the third string. And my 9 is the second string. Now, if I want to flat the 9, I call it a C7 flat 9. If I want to sharp the 9, then I've got a C7 sharp 9. Now let's move to our 4th string form. So this one has the root on the 4th string. We have the major 3rd on the 3rd string. We have the flat 7 on the 2nd string. And we have the 9 on the 1st string. And just like with the other one, if I want to flat the 9, or if I want to sharp the 9, I've got to call that a C7 flat 9 or a C7 sharp 9. Well, I hope that was a good introduction to jazz chords for you, Chuck. Wow, that was awesome. In fact, I was so inspired, I wrote a parody. Lights!
GFA. Oh, there's so much that I want to say. Nearly every day, it's much more fun. fun with GFA. Suddenly, I'm much better than I used to be. I use all fingers now and not just P. Oh, thank you, GFAtv. Now that season one is all done, what can I do? I know the GFA summit is taking place in June. I can't believe I can play what used to challenge me. I'm a future guitar hero wannabe. That's thanks to GFAtv. Thank you all for teaching me. Bye.
Hey everyone, my name is Michael Ibsen, and I'm here to give another lesson on thinking polyphonically, and specifically using the right hand to achieve specific voices within a texture, and to bring those voices out, to bring out specific notes, all that kind of good stuff. So first of all, let's talk about color and the different strings we have to play with. So on the guitar, we have, you know, six different strings, and there are three of them are made of slightly different materials. They are either nylon or carbon fiber, and then we've got the bass strings. Now, each string has kind of a different color. I know you're probably already aware that, like, open E sounds quite different than E on 5th fret 2nd string, than the E on the 3rd string, right? The colors are all different. This is probably not new to you. But that can affect how things work in a polyphonic situation, because, for example, the first string, open and in the first few positions, is incredibly bright, and it comes out of the texture really easily. So when we're trying to make a dynamic difference between different voices, we have to take that into consideration. Okay, so talking about how we actually produce dynamic differences on the guitar. When we're playing with our right hand, we produce a difference in dynamic based on how far we push the string before we release it. So I like to think of it like a little bit like a button you're pushing and then you let go of it. Or, you know, you're applying pressure and then the amount of pressure you apply changes the dynamic when you play it. So you can do everything from like just brushing the string and playing it, which produces, you know, a much softer sound. And obviously smaller motions can also produce a softer sound, to pressing in and then releasing, right? And that produces a much stronger sound. And then of course there's things like wrist stroke, appoggiando, which can produce even more power. But even with free stroke, if you're pushing into the string before you release it, you can produce a pretty powerful sound. So for example, the first example we're looking at today is this Tariga study, which we looked at last week as well. The notes with the accents are the voice we're trying to bring out. So as I was saying last week, this is a bit of deceptive polyphony. It looks like one voice arpeggio texture, but we realize that this is a little melody of E, G, E. And then in context, so right before I play those notes on the first string, I'm pressing the ring finger in a little bit more. And what that also means, it's not just how hard I play that note, it's also that I'm brushing very, very, very softly these two. So my index and middle finger are just kind of brushing those strings. Very often, if you want to bring out one voice, the best thing to do is to bring the other voices down and emphasize them less. Rather than pushing too hard on the voice you want to bring out. It's a combination of both, right? It's sort of like when you look at a painting, you see that in the foreground is the object or the person that's the focus of the painting, and in the background we have maybe some trees or a landscape or, you know, a cityscape, and it's often much less distinct. The colors are less vibrant than the object that's supposed to be the focus, right? So we're doing the same thing with a piece of music. We don't want the accompaniment part and accompaniment voices to be too loud. They can be much softer. So that's one example in this Tadiga piece. We're going to look now at a little Merz exercise, a simple little Merz exercise that also uses this kind of device. So in this one, the melodic material is not in the top voice. This is obviously accompaniment. I mean, we wouldn't have a melody that's just E, E, E. Instead, the melody is here in the bass. Now, what I was talking about before with considering the color of the strings is important here. This open E is really easy to make too loud, right? It's such a bright sounding string that it's really easy for the piece to sound like this, which we don't really want. We really want to put more weight here, but also even more importantly, these E's need to be quite soft. And, you know, thinking polyphonically again, you notice that here the stems are going down and we have that melody there. So from the very beginning, I would be practicing this piece considering the amount of weight that I'm using for each finger, because when we practice something with our right hand, we've developed muscle memory with it, right? So if you start from the standpoint of thinking polyphonically and applying the exact amount of weight you want to each finger, you will memorize, your body will memorize that, and then it won't be so difficult later to recreate that, right? So it's really important actually to think in quite a detailed way about the amount of weight you're using. So next I'd like to talk about thinking polyphonically and emphasizing certain notes within a chord progression, which is actually a lot more challenging. So this example is the second etude, etude number two by Leo Brouwer. Maybe you've played it before or heard it. So we're gonna look at these first three chords, which sound like this. Now that I was playing all the notes equally, sounds quite nice. There are actually three voices, right? We have B, C, B in the top voice, this. So let's hear what it sounds like if I put extra weight only on the middle finger, because I'm using P, I, and M, and I'm gonna emphasize just that note, and you'll hear me bring that voice out. Sorry. Da, da, da. The middle voice is A, G, A. A, G, A. So now let's emphasize that one. Sounds different, right? But kind of cool. And the bottom voice is D, A. That one. It's a minor third. I like the minor third interval. It's very nice. So then if I emphasize the bass, it'll sound like this. I think that's my favorite. It also sounds nice as you go forward. And then it sounds really cool when you have E, F, E here. I don't know why that bass line just makes me so happy. Okay, so you can already see how different this sounds when I emphasize certain voices. It may be that in the end you want to play this piece with, you know, all the voices equally, since it's supposed to sound like a chorale. That's fine, but this is a good example of how you can play with it a little bit, and you can choose to emphasize a certain voice if you feel like it at a given time. And it's also useful in a lot of other circumstances. So just to wrap up, I hope that you found this useful and helpful. You know, I think that starting from the standpoint of thinking polyphonically when you choose fingerings, and then also in memorizing your, you know, right hand attack and the way that you control the right hand when you play these different melodies, goes a really long way to helping to communicate the piece of music to the audience. You know, I think one of the coolest things about our repertoire as classical guitarists is that we get to play all these polyphonic pieces with multiple voices. You know, I think that for the audience, it helps a lot when they can hear these different voices interacting with each other. And it's sort of, I think for a lot of people who don't necessarily hear classical guitar, when they hear that, it really seems really special, because most styles of guitar, the guitar occupies either a melodic or an accompaniment role, not both. So I think if you apply these, you know, techniques with the right hand, and you choose fingerings based on the polyphonic nature of the piece you're playing, it will really, you know, transform your interpretation and help show the audience like the beauty of this music and the structure of the music, because there's so much detail there in how a lot of these pieces are written, and it really helps bring it across, even if it's difficult and we have to find, you know, compromises between what's possible and what's ideal. So I hope you found this helpful, and have a great day. Thanks.
Okay, let's be honest. Have you ever forgotten your music on stage? Forgotten your equipment or your sheet music at home? Or just dread performing in general? Unfortunately, these things happen to the best of us. And while it is impossible to be perfect, it is possible to minimize these sorts of mindless slip-ups with the creation of a productive routine. And that's exactly what I'm here to talk about today. Today we're going to uncover what it means to create a successful pre-performance routine. And I'm also going to tell you some techniques like positive self-talk, breathing exercises, and certain things you can keep in mind when creating your routine that will help better ready your mind and body for the big performance day. So without further ado, let's get right into it so that you are ready for your performances before you even make that first step onto the stage. Let's go. Okay, so first things first, when does the performance day start? It starts way before you walk out onto stage, it starts way before you get to the venue, it starts right when you wake up. So the number one thing you can do to best prepare yourself for performance day, right when your day starts, is with some positive self-narration. Positive narration is so important. If you go around the entire day thinking stuff like, oh man, I'm gonna blow it today, then I don't know, Chief, but you probably will blow it. It's so important to talk to yourself positively so that your mind gives the body the tools it needs to be successful. If you're constantly feeding your mind negative thoughts, your mind is going to give your body those negative thoughts, and it's just gonna be a disaster. So try to flip the script and say things like, you know what? You can do this. You prepared, you've got this. Things like that, they're helpful. And albeit cheesy, they are really, really useful. And if you use words like that and a mindset like that, you're going to be great. Or at least you're setting yourself up for success. I can't guarantee legally that this will make your performances better. Okay, so now that you're talking to yourself positively, it's time to talk about our first material thing we should probably start to have if we want to have a really good pre-performance routine. And that is a checklist. Checklists are so important. Check, check, check. Checklists help keep everything in order. It prevents crazy slip-ups, like the one time I drove out to my college audition and brought my pens, my sheet music, a banana, and left my guitar at home. When you keep a checklist, it can be something small, it can be in a notebook or anything. It can be laminated, right? But on your checklist, be sure to include anything that you might need. Include necessities and maybe some extras. I like to be the backstage parent personally, so I always bring one extra of everything just in case somebody missed a footstool or needs a snack. Some things to keep on your checklist are a guitar support, some extra strings, hair ties, footstools, those sorts of things, your guitar, a snack, and I personally like to bring some gloves and a jacket because sometimes stage managers like their backstages cold, like a meat cooler.
Guys, is he barking at the moon?
Okay, so now for the big grand finale of the video. What do you do when you're at the venue to get ready for performance? At this point, nerves are pumping. Audience members are filing in, or they're not, if your name is Xeno Muller and you're performing. But usually by this time, you're starting to feel things, and this is really an important time. Even though it's the shortest time in the day, it's arguably the most important and definitely feels like the longest. So I'm going to run you through some exercises to help you kind of get in the zone and embody the music, because at the end of the day, that's what's most important. Music is a performing art. It isn't there in the score. I think these words mean that music is a full body experience. Imagine a percussionist playing the marimba. It's very athletic. Just because we're guitarists and we sit in the same place doesn't mean we can't embody the music with all of our body. To get myself ready to do this sort of musical embodiment of sorts, I run through a couple breathing exercises, I meditate a little bit, and I also do something called shadow boxing, which we'll get to in a second. Before I talk more about these sorts of exercises, something else that's important to note is a backstage snack. Be sure to put this on your checklist, but anything high in potassium is really, really good to help calm your nerves, i.e. a banana or coconut water. Some performers like to have chocolate because the little tiny kick of caffeine helps, you know, get the nerves going. Some people like that. Some people like to feel like just, you know, and other people like to feel like, you know, I don't know. But yes, anything with high potassium is really, really helpful. I always bring a bunch of bananas. I return to monkey. Those are really helpful. But back to exercises. The first one I'd like to talk about comes from Gerald Klickstein's The Musician's Way. It's called two-in-one breathing, and it's all about breathing and counting. And I think it really helps put the mind at ease and help you focus on just one thing and one thing alone, and that's your breath. So to a moderate mental count, you're going to breathe in for a certain amount of time and then breathe out through your mouth through twice that amount of time. So in through the nose and out through the mouth. So I personally like to work in units of four. So I breathe in for 4 counts and I breathe out for 8 counts. When you're doing this exercise, you want to make sure that you repeat it enough times so that your mind feels at ease. I personally use this exercise before I perform and before I go to sleep because it really helps me just let go and be in the moment. Another exercise I like to do is shadow boxing. Shadow boxing is exactly what it sounds like. Don't punch any of your quartet members, but just find a space where you have, you know, room to swing your arms around and get in the moment and do some shadow boxing. It kind of helps you feel like strong, and it also helps get your body moving. So when you go out and do music, it's not like the first time you've ever moved your arms in your life. So there's that. That's about everything it takes to start a really, really basic and effective pre-performance routine. Positive self-talk, exercises, checklists are all things that are really useful. And, you know, pre-performance routines aren't for everybody. Some people really love to perform and just will roll out of bed in concert attire and show up and play great. Other people really rely on having a solid foundation. I'm kind of in the middle. There are a couple things I like to do just out of tradition, but I really love performing, so, you know, you don't have to twist my arm for me to do that. Anyways, what's most important is that you stay true to yourself and never ever stop shredding. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Have a good summer.